Today, the tank is an indispensable part of many armies around the world with powerful offensive and defensive capabilities. Sometimes, battlefield situations require vehicles that are both armored and have the mobility of tanks to perform specific tasks. One such type of vehicle is the Armored Multi-Purpose Engineering System. In essence, this is a heavily modified tank equipped with various pieces of engineering equipment. An excellent example is the AEV-3, nicknamed the Kodiak, currently in service with four armies in modest numbers. The Kodiak, based on the Leopard 2 MBT chassis, offers a high level of protection combined with good mobility. With the use of different modules, the Kodiak has a variety of uses, including breaching minefields and destroying or erecting obstacles. The history of the Kodiak began in April 2002, when Switzerland initiated its Armoured Engineer Vehicle 3, AEV-3 program. To speed up the development of this project, the strategic technology partner of the Swiss Army, RUAG Defence, created a consortium with the German Rheinmetall Landsysteme. Rheinmetall, with future sales in mind, nicknamed the project Kodiak for marketing purposes, referring to the Kodiak bear, one of the two largest species of bear. A team of experts from both companies worked closely together developing and manufacturing the new vehicle. After Arma Suisse, the procurement agency of the Swiss Army, handed over a surplus Leopard 2 chassis, construction of the prototype could begin. It would be completed shortly after, in May 2003. The vehicle was then ready for its first trials and was handed over to the Swiss Army for a two-month trial period. The vehicle passed all these tests successfully. In 2004, the Kodiak was shown at the biennial Eurosatory Defense and Security Exhibition in Paris. It sparked the interest of several Leopard 2 operating armies, including Denmark, the Netherlands, Spain, and Sweden. In the meantime, the Kodiak undertook a series of tests, including the Spanish Army base in Zaragoza. In early 2005, the Kodiak prototype was sent to Sweden to be tested under harsh winter conditions. The test confirmed that the vehicle met Swedish requirement for an armored high-performance multiple-purpose engineering system. During these tests, the vehicle was shown not only to operate well in cold climates, such as those of Northwest Europe, but that it performed equally well in warm environments. The Kodiak is powered by the MTU MB873 V12 twin-turbo diesel engine producing 1,475 horsepower. With it, a maximum speed of 68 km per hour can be reached. Weighing in at 62 tons, the vehicle falls in the MLC-70 class, military load class, NATO vehicle classification system based on weight. The weight is spread over 7 road wheels on each side and the tracks are guided by the 4 return rollers. These tracks can be tensioned with the front idler wheel and are driven by the drive sprocket at the rear. Although a large part of the chassis remains unchanged compared to the Leopard 2, the front armor plate and turret were removed to make place for a superstructure. This superstructure, with a heavy slope on the front and slight sloping on the sides and rear, extends approximately to the middle of the vehicle. It is split in two in order to accommodate the hinged arm excavator placed front center. A centrally placed excavator offers a major advantage to the crew, as not only do they have a better view of what they are doing, it also eases operation in confined spaces. The excavator bucket has a volume of 1 cubic meter, and when in continuous use, it can move up to 200 cubic meters of earth per hour. The arm has a horizontal operational range of 9 meters and a range of 8.2 meters vertically. The arm can also be used to lift objects up with a weight of up to 3.5 tons. The bucket is attached to the arm with a hydraulically actuated quick coupling device, so it can easily be detached and replaced by an alternative tool. Such tools include a universal gripper, a hydraulic hammer, an earth drill, a fascine launching system, and a concrete crusher. Two of these tools can be transported on the rear deck of the Kodiak above the engine deck, while additional ones can be transported separately by a truck. The crew can perform all these actions without having to exit the vehicle. Furthermore, the vehicle is equipped with two capstan-type Rotzler winches which can pull 9 tons each at a speed up to 90 meters per minute with a cable length of up to 200 meters. The Kodiak is manned by a crew of 3, a commander, a driver, and an engineer. but the vehicle is also fully operable when only manned by the commander and driver. As the crew compartment consists of two halves, the crew members are separated from each other, with the commander sitting in the right half, the driver in the left front, and the engineer behind him. The chairs, equipped with four-point belts, are fixed to the roof so that if the vehicle is hit by an explosive charge like a landmine or improvised explosive device, less of the force of the blast is imparted to the crew, reducing the risk of spinal injuries. Six cameras provide a panoramic surrounding view which allows the crew to fully operate the vehicle effectively, allowing for both enhanced situational awareness and navigational capabilities. To defend itself against near threats, the Kodiak is equipped with a weapon station on top of the right side of the superstructure. This station, which can be operated both manually and remotely, is armed with a 12.7mm machine gun, but can also be equipped with a 40mm grenade launcher. Furthermore, the vehicle is equipped with a smoke grenade launcher system, which is mounted on the front. Besides the conventional dozer, which has a width of 3.42 meters or 4 meters with side extensions, the Kodiak can be equipped with a mine plow. This mine plow was developed by the British company Pearson Engineering and is marketed under the name full-width mine plow, which clears mines and explosives down to 30 centimeters underground. With this mine-breaching method, a path of 150 meters can be cleared within 1 minute. It also featured an integrated electromagnetic system, meaning that explosives with electrical ignition explode immediately. When equipped, the plow adds 4 meters to the total length of the vehicle. To mark the breached path, the Kodiak is also equipped with a Pearson lane marking system. This system features two devices per side, containing 50 marker poles each. They are pneumatically fired into the ground at either time or distance-based intervals and have enough power to penetrate asphalt as well. The poles are equipped with LEDs so that a breach path can also be recognized during bad weather or nighttime. After the successful prototype trials, the results were shared with the International Kodiak Coordination Group, which consisted of Sweden, Denmark, Switzerland, the Netherlands, and Spain. This group was specifically established to harmonize national Kodiak requirements and programs. Despite the successful trials, the Kodiak project had some setbacks. Spain would go on to back out of the program, along with Denmark. However, in January 2007, Rheinmetall announced that the Swiss procurement agency had signed the first contract for the delivery of 12 Kodiaks, in Swiss Army parlance known as Genie Panzer. For this, the Swiss Army provided 12 Leopard 2 chassis with removed turrets. The deal had a value of $76 million. The first vehicles were planned to be delivered over the course of 2009. Construction was to take place in Switzerland by RUAG, assisted by Rheinmetall Landsysteme in Kiel. Production took longer than anticipated, and the delivery date was postponed to the end of 2010. A further setback was encountered in January 2011, when it became apparent that the hydraulic arm would overheat after only a short time of use, which meant that it had to be left to cool down before returning to action. Fortunately, the issue could be resolved, but the last Kodiak was delivered just before the end of 2011. Although 12 vehicles were ordered, only 6 Pearson mine-clearing modules were ordered. Since delivery, the vehicle have been in use with the 11th Battalion Combat Engineers. Sweden was another country that expressed an interest in acquiring the Kodiak. Way back in 1999, Sweden had also initiated a procurement program for a combat engineering vehicle. As the Leopard 1 chassis was rejected, they turned instead to the Leopard 2. To reduce costs, the Swedish procurement agency tried to collaborate with other agencies participating in the coordination group. An initial collaboration with Switzerland was set up, but had to be terminated in December 2001 due to a lack of funding from the Swedish government. Sweden was then approached by Denmark, but nothing productive came from this either. Sweden eventually initiated their AEV-3S Swedish program in 2005, with the Netherlands joining in 2006. On 16th of January 2008, the procurement agency of both Sweden and the Netherlands placed a combined order for 16 vehicles, 6 of which were for Sweden and the other 10 for the Netherlands. all for a total amount of 100 million euro. Sweden provided 6 Leopard 2 chassis for conversion. The chassis was shipped to Germany, after which they were converted to AEV-3S. In November 2011, the first vehicle was handed over to the Swedish Armed Forces Procurement Agency. The vehicles are operated by the two engineering battalions, which received 3 vehicles each. The Netherlands used Leopard 2 chassis from their own stock as well. 10 vehicles were completely overhauled by conservation company Land Systems in Leusden, and the turrets were removed. After these were converted in Germany and returned as Kodiaks, the vehicles were intensively tested. During these tests, several teething problems were resolved, including some major issues with the hydraulics. Eventually, on 31st of May 2018, the vehicles could finally be transferred into active service, as all problems had been resolved. In 2019, some of these Kodiaks were made available for use by the Very High Readiness Joint Task Force of NATO. Another operator that acquired Kodiak is the Singapore Army. A total of 14 Kodiaks were ordered and delivered between 2014 and 2015, replacing the aged US-built M728 CEVs. The Kodiaks in Singapore Army are designated as L2 AEV. These are operated by the 38th Battalion, Singapore Combat Engineers, together with the Leopard 2 AVLB. After 1989, the German Army has used the Leopard 1-based Pioneer Panzer 2A1 armored engineering vehicles. During the 2010s, the need emerged for a new vehicle based on the Leopard 2. Rheinmetall entered the competition with the Kodiak, while Flensburg-based FFG offered the Wissant 2. According to the original planning, a decision was to be made near the end of 2020, but this deadline was not met. Eventually, the Kodiak was chosen in early 2021, and on 14th April 2021, the Budget Committee of the German Parliament approved an order for 44 vehicles worth roughly 295 million euros. The new vehicle will be based on surplus Leopard 2A4 chassis from German Army stocks. It is planned that all 44 vehicles will be delivered from 2023 until 2029. The Kodiak is still marketed by Rheinmetall and RUAG to this day. Its main competition is the more recently developed Wissant 2, developed by the German company FFG, also based on the Leopard 2 chassis and already in use with the Canadian and Norwegian armies and on order by the Army of Qatar. Whether Rheinmetall will manage to secure future sales of the Kodiak remains uncertain. Still, potential buyers include Austria, Chile, Greece, Indonesia, Poland, Portugal, and Turkey, as these countries all operate Leopard 2 MBTs and are either operating older or no armored engineering vehicles. This concludes our video on the Kodiak. Will it succeed in gaining a wider popularity and see more services in the future, or has it missed its chance? Would it make a difference on the battlefields of Ukraine? Share your opinions in the comment section. If you haven't done so already, we invite you to subscribe to stay updated on future content. If you'd like to contribute further, consider supporting us on Patreon or PayPal. Your contributions help us create more engaging videos. Until next time, stay focused and stay tuned.